Hello everyone. So Rosalind Picard is here with us and she's going to talk to us about skin conductance and this kind of data a lot of us collect for our own research. And it has, in the past few years, it's been more and more difficult for us to conceptualize how meaningful or useful it can be for our research. So she has done some very interesting work on this and she has some interesting findings that she can share and hopefully lead us into some useful directions with regards to this research. She's the director of a few different, co-director and director of a few different organizations. And so please, Rosalind.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm, as you could tell, from the MIT Media Lab, and I've been over here a few times interacting with various of you, imaging the brain, always inspired by your capabilities. My work has been inspired by trying to come up with engineering objective tools to look at emotional information. And it started with wanting to understand when people who couldn't talk were feeling stressed or frustrated. It was brought to our attention that it wasn't just people diagnosed with autism who often have trouble understanding our feelings, but we too often have trouble understanding their feelings. They may, in fact, get so stressed on the inside that they may shut down on the outside and appear to be very detached and calm and maybe even like they're in their own world and maybe even like they're understimulated. But when you measure the physiological response, sometimes it's through the roof. And then you may have a surprise, thank you, where they look very calm on the outside, and you're, you know, clapping your hand like, come on, perk up, and then pow, you know, where did that come from? Where did the meltdown come from, right? They looked too calm, and suddenly they seemed overreactive. So how do we understand what's going on if what you see on the outside is a mismatch for what is going on the inside? And we were challenged to do this at school, on the playground, during occupational therapy sessions, at home, and it just isn't yet convenient to wear something that reads the brain directly 24/7. Maybe you have something to show me that's making progress there. I know there's a lot of cool gaming devices and so forth, and eventually maybe we'll have some implant that reads out some stuff. But right now, there wasn't anything that we could read out directly. So we have been interested in how could we read out emotional information. And a bunch of my team's work at MIT and also at a spin-out company, Affectiva, has been focused on reading facial analytics, facial expressions, muscle movements on the face. And those can be good, right? Smiles can mean that you're happy. Smiles can also mean you're frustrated. We've found 90% of cases where people were frustrated at MIT, they smiled, the true smile with the eye crinkles as well as the mouth. So the face does give us important information, and we've worked a lot on that, but that's not what I'm going to focus on today. Today I'm going to focus on something that you don't need a camera pointed at you with good lighting to look at. You just need to be able to wear somewhere on your skin, and that's the skin conductance. And most of our work has been done with a wrist-worn sensor, although we've also worn them in a lot of other locations. And this sensor was made by Affectiva. And they're not currently selling it right now. I'm in the process of setting up another business, hopefully to take care of that. But right now, we're kind of betwixt and between, which makes it easy for a conflict of interest, nothing to disclose right now. Now, what does this sensor measure? What we're interested in with the arousal dimension of emotion is usually the sympathetic nervous system response being activated, or the parasympathetic nervous system response being deactivated. Where interest, either one can, for example, make the heart go up. The autonomic nervous system actually has three branches, the sympathetic, the parasympathetic, and the enteric, which I'm not showing here, the gut brain, which is also fascinating. The two best known are the sympathetic and parasympathetic. And let's just go through a very simple example. Most organs get innervated by both. Take the heart. Your heart right now is at probably a resting heart rate. It's actually, the physiologists tell us, its natural state is to be revved much higher. But you probably have the parasympathetic vagal brake on right now that's kind of slowing it down to your resting level. Now, there are two ways it can go up. You can withdraw the brake, or you can step on the gas here, kick the sympathetic system. when we try to measure parasympathetic or sympathetic using the ECG, we can do spectral analysis and get out information that's a pretty good approximation to the parasympathetic. But we don't have a robust approximation to the sympathetic that we know how to get today from analyzing the ECG. Fortunately, there is one organ we know of that gets the pure sympathetic response. Anybody know what organ that is? Skin, excellent. So the skin is not shown here, but the skin has projections supposedly that are purely sympathetic. Now, this is not a new finding from us. It's been studied over 100 years. It's gone under a lot of different names: skin potential, skin conductance, galvanic skin response, admittance, impedance. There are a whole lot of different electrical ways to measure electrodermal activity. And traditionally, it's measured, in fact, the standard is to measure it using gelled electrodes on two fingers on the palmar surface. And devices have gotten fairly small to do that over the years. We used to duct tape them to your arm, you know, and gather it in daily life. But that really wasn't convenient to put on an active kid running around all day. So we developed at the Media Lab a bunch of other devices that measured from the palm or the wrist or the leg, were small and wireless, logged the data around the clock. And again, these have been commercialized, and although, again, not available in this forum today, but I'll pass around just an example of one of the pod sensors. It has snap-in electrodes that you put the sticky kind on. So with that, you can measure and compare multiple sites. You can easily stick it on palms, on wrists, on the sternum, on the back for a diabetic sweat, on different limbs, forehead. You can measure a lot of points on the body synchronized to get this information easily. To such great scientists here, this is going to seem a little comical, but I just want to make one point with this. Sweat glands, of course, are much more complicated than this. They're very twisty and so forth. But for those of you who are not electrical engineers, the basic idea is we're measuring the electrical conductance across the top of the skin here. Now, when you sweat and this level rises up and spills out and it's wet, it's very conductive. And so when you feel sweaty, you are very conductive. But even when you don't feel sweaty, even when no sweat has spilled out, just when the level changes, the hydration changes under the surface of the skin, it affects the conductance we measure on the surface. So even without any noticeable change in sweat, the innervation of these sweat glands by the sympathetic nervous system will cause our electrical signal to change. So we get a very sensitive measure. Let me play an example of this signal changing. And this was from a girl on the autism spectrum. See if I can get the movie to work from here. I probably should have. Cannot open the specified file already. Let's see if I can find my way around on this laptop here. Here, this will be it. We don't need that. Oops, let's get rid of that. All right, what do you see here? Let's find a peak moment. All right, this girl is wearing, see these black sweatbands around her ankles? She's wearing a version of a skin conductance sensor there. The other stuff here is some music therapy and all. It doesn't have anything to do with what we're showing you here. The blue graph here is a zoom in of this green graph down here. It's this little blue section here zoomed in. She's getting ready to have a little bit of a meltdown at this peak right here where she gets frustrated about something. She's having a hard time communicating. We assume that's the cause of the frustration here, typical cause. This right edge here is what you see right now in the video. So she's peaking right now. Okay, the two lines are her left and right ankles. All right, so in this case, what we saw on the outside is consistent with what we see on the inside. I chose an example of that to build a little trust here. Usually when people get stressed out and they freak out, the level is high. This was one of her peaks during the session here. Here's a similar peak where she just, actually, let's just look at some of these decays here. She gets in the ball pit. For a lot of people, deep pressure, physical contact, things that make you relax tend to be associated with declining skin conductance here. Certainty tends to help it. Here she's in ball pit. She gets out of the ball pit. It goes back up. Here she gets back in the ball pit and is going through her daily schedule. Knowing what's happening ahead can be very reassuring and calming for some people. And then here's the third big peak coming up. Here, there may be multiple things that contribute to skin conductance going up. It's important to understand the ambiguity, the lack of specificity here. The physical effort of getting on the swing, the motor planning, the cognitive load can make skin conductance go up, like physical effort. And so too can emotional arousal. So when it goes up, absent the other contextual information, there is an ambiguity that's important to understand, so we don't attribute it to the wrong cause. Also, for this girl, we see that there is a period of significant decay here where she's swinging the whole time. For many people, a repetitive rocking movement is very calming. People on the autism spectrum have often tried to communicate this, that their repetitive movements can be very calming. Although sometimes they say their repetitive movements can be stimulating. So go figure. But with something like this now, you can see, you can read out, is this a repetitive movement that's making them go up or a repetitive movement that's making them go down? And that's an intriguing piece of information to have to disambiguate what you see on the outside.
How much does temperature affect the
signals? Good question. How much does temperature affect the signal? If temperature and humidity are such that sweat starts pouring out of you, it can affect it significantly. Typically in controlled environments like what we have here, or in office environments, and in most of our daily environments, it is not correlated with the skin conductance. For example, during sleep, we measure temperature here also, and we added that originally because we thought some peaks we're seeing during sleep might be due to just sweating and being hot at night. And it turns out to not be correlated with temperature. That's also been confirmed not just with our sensor on the skin surface temperature, but also with core body rectal temperature readings. Another piece of work that's looked at that has shown that it was not correlated during sleep. So while the extremes that make you sweat can, of course, cause skin conductance to go up, generally speaking, over typical ranges, it's not correlated.
Has this conductive thing gone around the room fully?
I don't know. Pass it around, this conductive thingy, Q sensor. Okay, skin conductance sensor. We had a baby boom in our lab many years ago, and so a lot of babies wound up getting measured. And it was quite interesting. We didn't do any formal studies here, although you might know Martha Herbert at MGH, who is including Q sensor in a much more thorough systematic study of biomarkers in autism and using the sympathetic nervous system measure and how it develops early in life as one such measure. There was a paper, right after the war in Germany, one of those studies you worry about, where they measured 8 different physiological signals on infants multiple times a day throughout the first 8-plus weeks of life, and they looked for signs of circadian cycles coming online in infant development. And the skin conductance was the first of the 8 physiological signals measured to show a circadian cycle. It's interesting to see it laying down a pattern early in development and then asking, what might this mean? I think we have more questions than answers here. But there are very systematic patterns that we can now more easily measure and start to try to understand. Here's just a sample of one of the kinds of things we see. This is a baby who was nursing and seemed quite content. Fairly high ankle skin conductance here. This is the motion, the accelerometer. The device I'm passing around measures 3 things. It measures skin conductance, it measures temperature, and it measures 3-axis accelerometer for the movement. While nursing here, the skin conductance is low. All of a sudden, the skin conductance starts going up. After it peaks here, the baby starts screaming. And mom's like, what happened? And what's interesting is we see a little fidgeting, we see the skin conductance go up, and then we hear the crying. So we had some indications of restlessness and perhaps GI discomfort or something. We don't know what, at this point. A pediatric GI specialist was saying if you were to systematically see this, say 30 minutes after ingestion of food, it could help them pinpoint where discomfort or pain might be happening in the GI tract. We don't have that in this case here, but one could be systematic in looking at that. And then we see bouncing. If we'd heard the baby burp here, we would have probably had a much stronger explanation of what happened. As it is with many things, this one remains mysterious, but the baby's levels started to go down, and baby seemed calm again. We did some other tests. Let me give you the example of data. The first time I saw 24 hours of skin conductance data from, in this case, an MIT student. This each row is a day here, 24 hours. So here there's a lot of activation of the lab, chilling in front of TV, surprisingly huge peaks during sleep. I'll say a little bit more about that later. Low as expected during relaxing, and quite activated during lab. And again, actually, each day is normalized against itself here right now, so don't compare across days, but compare within a day. Here, the exam and studying, biggest peaks of the day. Sleep, though, is usually the biggest peak, which is counterintuitive. And lab, homework, studying tend to be the peaks. To the embarrassment of we MIT professors, the classroom activity is routinely the lowest. I've seen this when we've measured audiences. In fact, please keep asking questions, because when you ask questions, the audience's skin conductance goes up. We believe that facilitates learning and attention. And when, in fact, there's repeated long-duration PowerPoint, audiences have a decaying exponential in skin conductance, just like classroom activity. I'll come back to sleep later. We're starting, because it's so easy to get data now, we're starting to get long-term data and starting to build norms. You know, you take a number like your height. I mean, what does 5'8" mean, right? It doesn't really mean a whole lot until you look at a distribution of heights and you start to learn that, you know, maybe that's higher than average for an adult woman and shorter than average for an adult man. And a kid who's on the 90% growth chart and stays there is probably developing well, but if he suddenly goes from the 90% down to the 50%, you might start to worry about him a little bit, right? Getting the norms and understanding how the population is not just at a snapshot, but as it changes and as it undergoes a treatment or an improvement or something is really valuable. So we have been saying, starting to ask, what does this signal tell us? And this is the first data I know of that looks long-term at children with an autism diagnosis, in this case at the Grodin Center. I work with my colleague Matthew Goodwin. And I'm showing the simplest thing here. I'm just showing you the histogram of their average skin conductance level, or EDA, electrodermal activity level here, over 60 days. So there's 60 days of data in each of these graphs. This is one child. Now, interestingly, these two children, this child, in 60 days, never goes above an average of 1. They tend to have a fairly low skin conductance. The ADHD literature suggests that people with ADHD have a low skin conductance. They may need more stimulation to kind of pick them up. Jerry Kagan years ago found that his extreme introverts had low skin conductance that was fairly stable as a lifelong trait. His extroverts had low skin conductance. His introverts had high, which he suggested was consistent with the extroverts with the low skin conductance seeking more social stimulation to raise their level, and the introverts, it's already high enough, thank you, wanting a little bit more quiet. These two kids, interestingly, have averages. This kid's average is just less than 2. It's way above what this kid never even went to in 60 days. These are very different physiological distributions. These are the same. These kids are at the same school, the same days, the same weather, the same heat and humidity, the same kind of basic routines going on in their school day. So as much as one can try to keep the environment similar, that was done here, but we see these very different objective measures of physiological responsivity that is believed to reflect this sympathetic nervous system activation. So one might then say, gee, you know, they have the same label, the same diagnosis, but they're physiologically very different. I don't know how many of you saw Tom Insel's blog recently. He's the director of NIMH, and he was talking about the new DSM coming out and the labels, you know, being useful for clinicians, you know, to give a diagnostic label to a condition like autism spectrum disorder. But ultimately, they're inaccurate when it comes to understanding, you know, what's the difference and how is this, what does this individual really have going on? One kid with autism may have hyper auditory sensitivity. Another one may be under responsive in that category, right? What we really want to know is what's objective and true about each individual person. I'm going to tell you a story that leads into the next piece of work that's been consuming me a lot lately. This was an accidental finding. One of my undergrads, you might know MIT has a Europe program, undergrad research opportunities, and one of our Europes came to me toward the end of the term, and he said, "Hey, Roz, I wonder if I could borrow a wrist sensor for my little brother. He has autism. He can't talk, and I want to see what's stressing him out, what's frustrating him." And I said, "Okay, over the break, there's nobody doing studies with these. Here, take one. In fact, take two. I'd take a soldering iron also, because back then we hand-built them, and I figured it might fall apart on him. I was always fixing the wires myself and trying to get them to last longer before we made them commercially." So he's got his little brother wearing, fortuitously it turns out, two sensors. And I'm back at MIT in my office over the break looking at the data online. And the first day looked like a typical autonomic profile, and the second day looked like a typical autonomic profile. I keep going, and all of a sudden, I saw something that made my jaw drop. He was, first of all, let me just tell you, he was wearing them on both the left and the right wrist, which I thought was completely redundant. Why do you need that? In all the studies I'd seen, the two sides were the same. Right? Maybe there was a slight calibration difference. On this screen, one of the signals went through the roof. It was so high that I figured, oh darn, the sensor's broken. The other one, I'm zooming in trying to convince myself there's some little response there, but honestly, it was like a noise response. There was essentially no response on the other one, so I thought that sensor was broken. The only problem was the data looked perfectly fine up to that event, and it looked perfectly fine after that event. In fact, it had a very characteristic sleep pattern after the event. It just jumps out at you. You can learn to read these when you see a bunch of them. And so I scratched my head, I'm zooming in, I'm, you know, totally befuddled. All my electrical engineering explanations don't explain this. Finally, I give up and I call him at home. "Hey, sorry to bug you at home over break. Hey, how's it going? How's your little brother? Hey, any idea what happened to him December 26th at 4 o'clock? And he said, "I don't know, I'll check the diary." I'm like, what are the odds this MIT student has written this down? You know, kind of preparing myself for disappointment. Well, he comes back and he says, "What time?" And I said, 4 o'clock, 7:26. Yeah. So he says, "That was 20 minutes before he had a seizure." And I went, wow. Next thing I know, I'm on the phone with Dr. Joe Madsen, who some of you may know over at Children's Hospital, the dad of another Europe. "Hi, Dr. Madsen, you don't know me, your daughter works in my lab. Joe does vagal stimulator implanting." And I'm like, "Hey, Joe, is it possible that one of your patients could have a sympathetic nervous system surge 20 minutes before a seizure?" He said, "Probably not. Probably not before the seizure actually starts in the brain, but maybe before the outward clinical signs, maybe before the person, you know, in the family saw it and wrote it down." And then I screwed up my courage and asked him the other weird question, which is, "Joe, is it possible it could happen on only one side?" We hand-built these things, like maybe they weren't reliable or something. He said, "Well, that's really interesting." He said, "You know, we have patients who will have their hair stand on end on one side before a seizure, or they'll have goosebumps on one side, or one pupil will dilate and not the other." He said, "This is really interesting." He said, "Why don't we, you know, get IRB approval and do a study?" So we did exactly that. 4,000 hours, more than 4,000 hours of data later, 100% of the seizures labeled blind to our data by two expert epileptologists agreeing on them based on the EEG criteria, 100% of them had enormous skin conductance responses on the wrist. This is an example just from one boy. Remember I showed you that MIT student where the sleep peaks were the biggest peak of the day? These are this boy's sleep peaks. This is 24 hours of data here. This is a teenager. Some good sleep activity here. The actigraphy is small here. Those of you who use your smartphone or a Fitbit or whatever to measure movement for your sleep, that's basically what this track is down here. When it looks like this, the boy's fairly inactive and possibly asleep. Here we see huge surges in activity with these jerking generalized tonic-clonic seizures here, here, and here. The red is the onset of the seizure labeled by the epileptologist. Now, it turned out that usually our data was not peaking 20 minutes before the seizure. Usually our data starts to peak when the seizure starts. We do have a couple cases where it peaks far in advance, and we're following up on that to see if there are certain people for whom we could get advanced prediction of seizure. But we do not have formal results where we can claim that with any statistical significance right now. But we can claim statistical significance with the these huge responses for the grand mal seizures, the generalized tonic-clonic seizures, the convulsive ones. Let me play a movie, see if this will play, of a child teaching you how to respond to seizures. Kids do a really nice job there. So what did they say? When do you call the ambulance?
5 minutes, sir.
5 minutes, sir, if they keep coming, right? Well, it turns out that in 7 out of 8 cases where a patient happened to be wearing an ambulatory EEG when they died of a seizure, and these are from the literature, the seizures were shorter than 5 minutes. And the hallmark of them was not the thing that seems to be associated with SUDEP, let me actually tell you what that is first. The thing people are worried about is sudden unexplained death in epilepsy. They're also, of course, worried about you hitting your head or stuff like that. But it turns out the number one cause of death is SUDEP. And the recent 2012 IOM report said it's the number one cause of death in epilepsy as a whole, not just the earlier finding, just number one for children and adolescents. They believe it's been underreported a lot. Now, this is odd. The explanation for the number one cause of death is an unexplanation. There's a lot of research trying to figure out what this is. Maybe people here will have some insight into this since you're amazing brain experts. There's a lot of mystery here. And one of the pieces of the mystery is that the brain waves, PGES, is post-ictal generalized EEG suppression. The brain waves are sometimes suppressed for a long time after a seizure. And they can be suppressed a long time or not at all, or a short time, it's variable. And it has nothing to do with how long the seizure was. It does tend to happen more often after the more severe generalized tonic-clonic seizures than after the supposedly less severe complex partials, but it can happen after either. And we found that the longer those brainwaves were suppressed after the seizure, the bigger the response on the wrist. We also found this robustly with two different measures, area under the curve and amplitude, which was not to be expected initially. We also found that the, here's the graph I just showed you. We also found, the P jumped off of here, but both of these are statistically significant, that the parasympathetic activation measured as the high frequency of the heart rate variability spectral from the spectral analysis of the intermediate intervals of the ECG, is also correlated with this duration of brainwave suppression. So the more brainwave suppression, the more you're stepping on the gas here. The more brainwave suppression, the more you're deactivating the brake over there. That is a dangerous combination for a cardiac event. When these things are co-occurring, it could put your heart into a dangerous state. But it's still mysterious why the brain waves are being suppressed. And originally people thought the whole brain was shutting down after the seizure when this happened. What this can look like, here's an example from one of our patients. Here's time in seconds. So this seizure is lasting about 90 seconds here. GTCS, generalized tonic-clonic seizure. Post-ictal generalized EEG suppression here, where the brain waves are defined to be below 10 microvolts. And then ordinary brain activity here, each of these in the EEG channel. Here is the aligned skin conductance response in this case. We're seeing one morphology of the signal climbing here, a very different characteristic and significant climb while supposedly the brain is shutting down. That doesn't make sense. Something must be activated in order to cause the skin conductance to go, because the kid hasn't just gone out into a steam bath, right? He's in a controlled hospital environment during our particular measurements here. And then we see resumption of normal brain activity and skin conductance still quite activated here. Now, this is scalp EEG. And what we've been learning from the epileptologists, and sorry, you guys probably already know this, but a lot of people I've worked with don't, the scalp EEG isn't telling you necessarily what's going on in the amygdala or the hippocampus or some of these deeper subcortical structures where depth electrodes may show that something is seizing down there while the EEG may show nothing is happening. We also have evidence now of subclinical seizures, and, you know, seizures where nothing is seen on the outside, and also where the EEG is completely missing the seizure, but we're seeing huge spikes in the skin conductance that do not appear to be explained by anything else. So now we're working with the experts with the depth electrodes to look inside to confirm that these might be what we think they are. And there's a lot of converging evidence now on this. Let me give you a couple more pieces of it. I never had medicine 101, but I was told that this is basic. They teach you that all of us in embryonic form have these three kinds of tissue. And when I made this throwaway comment once that I would have never in a million years gone looking for deep brain activity on the wrist, you know, like what a good way to get yourself kicked out of MIT, definitely wait till you have tenure to bring that one up. This doctor came up to me and she said, oh, that's not surprising. The skin and neural tissue have, you know, were together from development, right? These were enfolded together. And so to find that even in a fully developed individual, there are tight electrical mappings between these is no surprise to people who remember this. You probably also know from lots and lots of brain studies looking at subcortical left-right activation that there are some differentiations that have been shown in a number of studies related to the right amygdala supposedly and right-handers being more responsive to threat negative stimuli and the left being more mixed in its responsiveness. Now, why is that interesting here? Well, back to the left-right difference. What could have explained that in this kid? Well, it turns out that a study was done by Mangina and Bujra and Mangina with epilepsy patients where they went in and they directly stimulated the right amygdala, the left amygdala, the right and left anterior hippocampus, posterior hippocampus, cingulate, frontal cortex, mid T2, these different regions. The cortical were pretty symmetric. Both sides of the skin conductance lit up the same. But these particular subcortical regions, in particular the amygdala, had strong ipsilateral mappings. Stimulate the left amygdala, you get a huge left skin conductance. Stimulate the right amygdala, you get a huge right skin conductance. So this is really intriguing, and this could explain what we saw in our very first case of this. Perhaps the boy was having a seizure in a structure that gives a response on only one side of the body. There are also some other parts of the brain that give more contralateral responses too. I believe the motor is more contralateral. So one has to be careful, again, thinking about which regions are activated when measuring something like this. So what we're finding is that while we always used to think the two were the same, and actually this is not 100%, right? It's mostly the left, there was a little bit of activation on both sides. But generally speaking, there are some structures that appear to activate the same side. And in particular, the amygdala, posterior hippocampus, anterior hippocampus, and anterior cingulate have a very strong ipsilateral mapping from these studies. Now, how does this relate back to us? It helps give us some interesting new kinds of experiments we can do. And we've already been finding some evidence for these now that we go back and look at it a little bit differently. So this was data when yours truly was just collecting, just testing four sensors. Originally I slapped them on four places of the body, two wrists, two ankles, just for all day logging, checking them out, making sure they work, while I took my son to Six Flags and some of his friends. So this is the enormous arousal on my right wrist, left leg, right leg. The ipsilaterality does not seem to hold below the waist. It seems to crisscross. The biggest peak of the day here was, I don't want to talk about this ride. I dreaded this ride. I did not want to go on this ride, and they wanted to go on it repeatedly. So it was both negative and arousing, and was awful. But then I got them hooked on roller coasters, which I love. And these are teaching them how to ride roller coasters. This is the fastest, highest, most exciting roller coaster in all of New England. To my surprise, though, the biggest peak of the day was not one of these intense G-force rides, and you can see the G-forces in the accelerometer track that I'm not showing you here, but they nicely align with those worst or best moments of the falls. The biggest peak actually was getting out the door in the morning. Those of you who have kids are probably the ones laughing. And interestingly, it wasn't just, you know, like, do we have everything to get out the door? This was quite different from that. This was a morning where, let me just tell you, this whole event had been planned once before, and it had had to be called off. And I was afraid it was going to have to be called off again. The night before, one kid was sick. There are only a couple kids coming. The other one's like, oh, I don't know if we're going to drop him off. We may come with our family and bring him later. I'm like, oh, no, my son's not even going to want to go if his friends don't show up. And just that morning, one of them's on the porch, and I'm arm-twisting them into, you know, like coming along with us. So this was actually for a mom. I don't know if you've ever planned an event you really want to succeed. For me, this was like a threat situation. I wanted this to succeed, and it was not under my control. And I was really hoping it would work out. And interestingly here, it's not just that this is high, it's that the right is way higher than the left here. Look at that asymmetry. That's really interesting. Now I'm a right-hander, this is just one set of data, and now we're doing much more systematic examination of this. But if you're interested in this, and you do, you know, personal threat or social phobia or these situations, it seems to be very important to pick situations that really matter to people, like a mom's son's birthday party that really matters that it be a success. Dangling a fake snake picture in front of me just doesn't do it, right? I don't get this asymmetry. Public speaking, I can, you know, be perfectly fine, although once there was a extremely high stakes talk and, you know, major funding people, and everything started to go wrong, all my AV started to blow up, and I was recording my left and right, and my right went way above my left during that moment when everything started to go wrong. They told me I looked cool, looked fine on the outside. Judging outwardly, people would have said everything was cool, calm, and collected. But inwardly, I think my right amygdala knew to activate a little bit more than my left. That's one possible explanation. The objective data showed the right went much higher than the left. We're seeing this also.
Parts of the body lateral, connect better per se with other brain structures?
That is a great question. So I've been talking to some neuroscientists about, you know, hey, when folks are in the scanner, can you hook up all these different locations and let's measure, you know, simultaneously what's happening on the legs and the wrists and the sternum? We are getting some different patterns, especially during sleep versus wake. And I'd love to work with folks like you to map out, you know, back to BrainMap project here. Let's map out this, you know, this neural dermal connection and figure out, you know, what these do and don't tell us. I'd love to do that if any of you are interested. I know John Gabrielli at MIT's expressed interest, Richie Davidson's expressed some interest, you know, some of them. Also, we're seeing, there's a bunch of work we've been doing on pain that I'm not yet at liberty to talk about, so I'm just gonna show you a few teasers here. And we're seeing similar things. Here's a person who's not afraid of a flu shot, going to get a flu shot. Here's the shot. The shot itself doesn't seem to be causing any huge increase, but there's this asymmetric increase right before the shot. And this is a person who's not even afraid of shots, right? Just sort of a normal, you know, response to here it comes. But it's an asymmetric anticipatory response. Here's a person, actually this is a left-hander, who came in expressing that she was miserable coming back from the dentist, feeling she looked miserable, lots of pain, she hadn't taken any painkillers yet. Interestingly, she's usually the same on both sides. Here, her left was much higher than her right. I gave her some over-the-counter Tylenol that I had on me. She went into a meeting that she was running. I was attending the meeting. She appeared to be, things were going great in the meeting, under control, things were working out, team was working great together. And she looked better during the meeting. I doubt the Tylenol had that much effect that quickly, but maybe it did. But it could have also just been her mindfulness of really being engaged and running a great meeting. And she said afterwards she didn't notice the pain. And interestingly, the gray area here is the time of the meeting. And we see, you know, the asymmetry basically going away during that time. I wish we had much longer follow-up here, but we don't. Peter Weinstock at Children's is now using this as one of several signals he measures in pediatric pain situations, and he calls emotion the fourth vital sign. Let me say a little bit about sleep, those sleep peaks. This is an adult, this is a hypnogram, wake, REM, stage one, stage two, stage three, red is REM here, this is one night's sleep. This person has huge sleep storms. If you zoom in on these, it's high frequency for electrodermal activity can be anywhere from like 4 to 17 peaks per minute here, usually around about 5 to 8. And this, so if you zoom in on this thick area, it's high frequency peaking. For this person, it's happening in the latter part of stage two, and then they go into REM. Then it starts again in the latter part of stage two, and it ends right when they go into REM. It starts again here, but it's interrupted by wake. If you zoom in on this, it meets the peaking criteria, and it goes straight into REM again. Zoom in here, it meets the peaking criteria, but it's interrupted by wake. These stormy periods, it turns out, are more than 90% of the time happening in non-REM. And we don't know why. We know when we see activity like this during wake, that it's usually a sign of incredibly focused attention. Somebody's concentrating on a task and they're really in the groove, focused on it. And when we see it during sleep, it was just baffling to us initially. And so we've been getting a lot more data. If you see arousals while the person's awake, falling asleep, that could be like insomnia, stress, you know, I can't sleep kind of thing. And this is a case of that where the kid expressed in the morning that he was all stressed out, falling asleep, wearing all this electrodes on his head. And here his electrodermal activity is showing that. This is a boy with autism, and he goes straight into the storming beforehand. Interestingly, here's some more deep sleep over here where he's not storming. And we have several examples like that where these kids who are very atypical storm a lot in the beginning and then don't storm the rest of the night. I've only seen that kind of rarely in healthy folks. Now we're trying to figure out what these storms really mean. We've been working with Bob Stickgold on this. You may know him. He's an expert on memory and dreaming and learning during sleep. We've been using his visual discrimination task that has pretty well established in sleep literature and trying to figure out if these storms have anything at all to do with learning. Again, because we see that kind of behavior during wake, highly engaged attention. So we took Bob's classic BDT task where they look at response times for detecting things like the T or the L. And if you're faster, they assume you're better, and they train you on it before sleep, and then they test you on it when you wake up. And previously, the best sleep features based on EEG that they had found, the predicted performance in this task, had to do with how much slow-wave sleep you got in the first quadrant of the night and how much REM you got in the fourth quadrant of the night. And the more you got of slow-wave sleep early and of REM later, the better you did on this task. Well, we also found similar performance. We took a different approach. We used machine learning to go through the EEG features and figure out which ones were best. And we also used lots of different kinds of machine learning to see if it was robust. It's pretty robust to get close to 60% prediction accuracy of the best performers versus the worst performers, slightly better than 50-50 using EEG. It turns out, however, that when we gave the machine learning the choice of EEG, electrodermal activity, accelerometer, again, that's what's in the Fitbits and iPhones and all, EDA plus accelerometer, or all of these, including EEG, that every machine learning method did better when it just used the EDA features. And that was very interesting. And it's doing better than when it just used the EEG features. This is for predicting the top half of the performers, top 33% of the performers versus bottom 33% of the performers. So we're still trying to figure out exactly what this is. and why sometimes it's there and why it's not. We're also looking at the asymmetry of it. Yep.
Are you not surprised at the reduction in accuracy with all the features? And does that suggest that they're all correlated with the EDA but noisier? I mean, you wouldn't expect the accuracy to go down.
Yeah, actually, I should probably give a long talk on this. We just have a short paper on this right now, but in the longer version, I would walk through lots of different ways of pulling subsets of the features, where we use all the features, which is overkill and hurts performance, versus we do various kinds of feature selection that are stratified, taking like the top three features from each of the categories, or we say take the top 12 features across all the categories, irrespective of how it represents them. We've got results on all, a ton of different ways, and this is representative of the taking all of them. So some of them will do slightly better or worse, but we are consistently finding that the EDA is either the top or in like the top if there's a tie.
Have you done any discriminant analysis that ranks features like random forests? We can look at information gain for each dimension.
We do not have a random forest method here. We have principal components, sport vector machines, k nearest neighbor. We could do that and then go like through the tree and figure out exactly which ones are key. We did couple this with what's called sequential floating forward feature selection that lets us pull out the optimum thing to do if you have n features is to search all 2^n combinations, which is intractable because we have over 100 features here. So what we did was a suboptimal SFFS method for searching, which does pull out the winning features. So like a tree method will give you, we do get a set of identified winning features. It's not just a black box here, and I can give you those. In fact, that's part how we pulled out the EDA ones when we did the op.
You keep an eye on time here, because we have to end and have time for questions. I will just say that this was data from yours truly after a very tragic, unexpected death in my family. And I was having trouble talking. And concurrent with that, I went very asymmetric for a while, which is very unusual for me. This was my sleep. Right was much higher than left. Probably shouldn't say right wrist and brain, but this is just right wrist, right? We think now that could have some association with more right brain activation during this time of grief. And then it gradually recovered and went back to what's very normal for me, where the two sides swap during sleep stages. These big high-frequency regions are likely to be non-REM for me. I usually skip storming in the first stage and then have most of the storming here. These trifurcations and all are also very unusual. I don't think I've ever seen that in me other than when this event happened. It's quite interesting. This is much more normal for me. All right, last slide. Time for a few more questions. What is this kind of, I started with the story of we're trying to understand the feelings of individuals who couldn't talk and wound up, building a device that went out into the wild and gathered objective data, inadvertently discovered that it was related to seizures and interesting sleep patterns and all these other things we didn't even set out to find. We just had a robust data collection device. And I want to go back to the beginning of the story, and this is with this time an adult who could talk. In fact, she was giving a talk that night, a 3-minute talk, at a meeting called Autru. It's a retreat organized by people on the autism spectrum, for people on the autism spectrum. I've been a guest there many times, really enjoyed it. And she asked me if she could borrow a sensor to wear for her talk. She thought it was gonna really stress her out and it would be her biggest peak of the day. And other than this horrible sensory microphone squelch here, a few bad AV things here, this is the biggest peak. This is her 3-minute talk. But before the event started, first of all, the event was supposed to start at 8. And a little bit before 8, she learns that the event is gonna be delayed. Now, having things go according to plan is a stress reducer. Having plans change is a stress increaser. And when she heard the event was gonna be delayed, she stressed out and she started pacing. Now her male friend who was sitting nearby was bugged by her pacing and he told her, stop pacing, that doesn't help, right? So she goes from pacing to, she describes later, stimming. I said, what do you mean by stimming? She said, well, I was kind of flapping and rocking and doing this kind of thing to calm myself down. And then the event starts, she gives her talk, and she stays up to help with these AV problems.
after the event, we see this nice coming back down to a level before, a little bit below that. She's interacting with people socially. She says, let's look at my data. We weren't looking at it live this time. And we pull the data up. It's time synced to the clock. We're looking at it, and her friend looks at the time track, and he's the first one to speak. And he says, I'm not going to tell you to stop pacing anymore. He noticed that this time was associated with the decline in her level. The next morning, I saw the two of them before another event. This time, she was pacing, and he was just sitting there ignoring her and typing. Now, I don't know how long this kind of don't pace, you know, it bugs me thing had been going on, but when he saw that that was associated with a decrease for her, he thought, well, maybe it is helping her. She keeps doing it, and maybe it does calm her down. Now, this is not proving that pacing calms everybody, right? But when you have data that shows people outwardly what's going on with you inwardly, it can change the conversation. It can go from me telling you what's right for you to me saying, that's another important piece of information. Let's take that into consideration as well. Let me end with a few minutes for questions. We have a URL where there are papers that go into much more detail on everything I've described for you here. Thank our generous sponsors. And we also have some MATLAB code free up on the web that helps people process a lot of this stuff too, if you're interested. Happy to share that with you. And I'd love to take a few questions too, if there's time. Thank you.